Brick Lane, home to some of the most successful immigrant groups in the UK. Going back all the way to the 17th century, it was said that Brick Lane was a rundown area, if not the most rundown area in London. Home to Victorians, then Jews and Asians, and so much more. Today, Brick Lane is a fully functional, multicultural area, home to both independent and commercial businesses such as restaurants, markets, art shops, fashion, and so much more. Roughly around 85% of independent businesses make up Brick Lane, and 70% of those independent businesses are Bangladeshi owned. People who live and work around Brick Lane are still very much working class people. The struggle for housing and economic changes has been gradually affecting Brick Lane and its people in so many different ways. Gentrification is something Brick Lane has been facing for many years. And if you take a walk through other high streets like Tottenham or Hackney, all you need to do is ask the locals or have a look on Google in how it was 25 years ago. And it's obvious. The businesses and the rich people are buying everything around there, changing the culture, and just kind of erasing everyone who built it over the years. Join me on this journey to find out how gentrification affects everybody in Brick Lane. Recently, I went to Brick Lane and I saw a huge banner saying, "Stop the Truman Brewery." Initially, I had no idea what this Truman Brewery was. So after doing a little digging around, I found out that it's an organisation building a shopping mall and offices in the centre of Brick Lane. But there's more to the story. I went around and asked some of the local businesses in what's happening with this development. But nobody even knew when it's happening. I feel like all of these businesses were kind of being left in the dark with it all. The most I got out of people is that the local council of Tower Hamlets has approved everything and it's going ahead. But as to what extent it's going ahead and what is actually happening, nobody really knows. I came across the hashtag Save Brick Lane campaign, which led me to an individual named Jonathan. He taught me about the history of Brick Lane alongside the reasons as to why the Truman Brewery need to be stopped. This is what he had to say.
This whole site here, which is about 10 acres, I think, is all under single private ownership. I'd say hitherto it's been somewhat benign ownership. I mean, effectively what's happened is they've brought these buildings back to life. They haven't acted as redevelopers in that sense. But now things are changing and they put in a planning application to put up a new building over here along Woodsear Street. Now, at the moment, this is a car park and there's a wall along here, quite a high wall, and along here are a row of houses. So Woodsear Street itself is a fairly quiet residential street at the moment. The construction here, they want to bring it up to about the same level as this. If you see this bulk here, they want to repeat it along here. It's going to be on the ground floor, it's going to be a shopping mall, and then with offices above, including a row of shops along Woodsear Street. So it will transform Woodsear Street completely to a completely different kind of environment, with a row of shops on one side facing the houses on the other. And actually, if you look up here, that gives you an idea of what it looks like. There are a few different layers of issues here. One is strictly about the development itself. The concern is that the site is all under single ownership, and it's really not possible to make decisions about what's appropriate development unless you've looked at the plan for the whole site. Now, we haven't, no one's seen a master plan for the whole site. Presumably there is one under private ownership, given that the planning process is all about decisions like this going to the council, so effectively under a local democratic system, we're being asked as a local democracy to make a decision about whether this is a good development or not. Well, it kind of depends on what else is going to happen, and we don't know. There are deep concerns that the use of this space as a shopping mall is completely inappropriate for Brick Lane and will negatively affect the existing context of Brick Lane. It will bring in, well, there's a couple of things about that. One is they're trying to create a new street here to align with this private street called Dray Walk, which already is under control of a single private owner. So they want to effectively double that kind of level of activity and footfall, but completely internally within the Truman Brewery site. So none of that increased footfall will benefit the independent traders and community of Brick Lane. In fact, quite the opposite. It might draw some of that, draw more of it internally into the Truman Brewery site.
After doing a little bit more research, I found out that the Truman Brewery actually owned a lot of the area around Brick Lane. On top of that, they've already made adjustments there and not really told anyone about it. The locals made complaints about this, but the council didn't really pay too much attention. They were too slow in replying, and they basically said by law there's nothing that they can do. I wanted to explore the other side of the story as well. Who is actually in favour of the Truman Brewery being built? I went to a protest in Brick Lane, led by the Save Brick Lane campaigners. It's important I find out how this affects the people of Tower Hamlets as well.
Now, one of the things we want to share with you, we're one of the 7 groups involved in this campaign, and we've been working with 6 other organisations since last summer. So this campaign may have been something you've heard about recently, but we have been doing all the things, all the admin Zoom calls, Microsoft Teams calls, late night calls, whatever we needed to do, everything we're doing behind the scenes. What that includes is every weekend, also on the weekdays, we've been knocking at local residents' homes. So all the estates around Weaver's Ward and Spitalfields and Bangla Town, it's literally all these individuals stood here. We've been knocking on people's doors, and I can see a few of the people I knocked on their doors on who are here. So thank you so much for coming.
Dr. Fatima Regina, I'm one of the co-founders and members of Nijjor Manush. We're an organization set up by 10 Bangladeshis from across the country. It's a national organization where we want to organize and politically educate and organize the Bangladeshi community, but also others affected by similar issues that impact our community.
We wanted to honor the histories of our past, South Asian activists from the 70s and 80s, the radical histories. We wanted to bring that past to this generation, and our main goal was really to organise the diaspora, to politicise them and to empower them.
And Bangladeshi diaspora in this area and around the UK has always been radical, has always fought, has always been underserved, has always been a working class community that hasn't had the state or any privilege in its favour, and has always organised its way out of that.
For the younger generations, for me, I take a lot of pride and connection in the long history of like anti-fascism and anti-racism in this area. And even when I would do my oral history work, you know, you learn so much about how Bengalis have been here, you know, for time. And I'm documenting the experiences of Bengali women. And, you know, we've been here, you know, we have a right to afford to live here. And this proposal is going to push us out. And it's going to really isolate Bengali communities from one another between generations. And it's going to strip away this area from the really incredible, beautiful and expansive heritage, you know, that's been here for a while.
Hey, I'm Samia. I've just eaten loads of biryani. But I am a DJ. I also produce animation, trying to learn to produce. I'm Bengali, and today we're here at the Save Brick Lane protest, rally, demonstration, whatever you want to call it. I'm Bengali, and I'm born in Bangladesh, but growing up in London, I've lived in East London, I'm now living in South London, I'm from Croydon, but I think it affects me every day because I can see the whole streets just changing overnight. And I think gentrification happens, and sometimes people often think it's improving an area, but a lot of the people who walk through these streets, I don't think even realise the amount of essentially bloodshed or just like severe social cleansing and general like punishment has to be endured by the lower socioeconomic cultures and backgrounds. And that's quite often the Bengali people who have been prized out of the curry houses and the places we've owned for years. We are the fabric that have made these streets what they are today. Half of it's already gone. You walk down it, you could probably not even tell that it was ever a community of Bengali people who lived here. And beyond that, our brothers and sisters who are from Pakistan and all of the diaspora and beyond, it's a place to be shared. But if we no longer exist here, and if we're not being taken into account, if there's a shopping centre being built in the middle of our streets that doesn't actually care about the fabric of our community, I feel as though what are they giving back to us if we have to be here fighting and standing to oppose this because no one else will? So I'm here for that.
And it made me think a little bit more what gentrification really is. The idea of everybody in Tower Hamlets, they can see central London just literally around the corner, but they can't really touch it, if you know what I mean. Society as we know it here in the UK is a democracy. But judging by the facts here in Brick Lane, it seems like a cycle of unfair systems which mainly affects the working class. My name's Kai. Thank you for joining me on this journey.